How did the world all collectively decide to watch Squid Game? It's not exactly a comfort show after all. Why did we decide that emotionally scarring gruesome games and economic instability were what we needed to cope with the current, state of the world? How did we get here and how are Fall Guys and Among Us involved? I think there are quite a few reasons why Squid Game rose so quickly in popularity, and I'll dive into each reason with you, because it's all just fun and games, right? To start, Squid Game is not another reused, recycled, live-action remake of a popular existing IP. Think how many Spider-Man films there are now, how many classic Disney animations now have live-action remakes, how many superhero movies and now shows there are. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with any of these, it's just that these characters are very familiar and the stories can start to feel like tried and true formulas after a bit. But Squid Game is something new. It's a change of cinema scenery. It's kind of like things we've seen before, but it's not exactly. We connect to a whole new cast of characters and get our collective hearts ripped asunder when the unexpected, yet totally suspected, comes to pass. Squid Game is a breath of fresh air. But it's not only that Squid Game is a fresh, new show. Plenty of new and unique shows don't blow up quite as spectacularly as Squid Game did. And for that, I think we have to thank two very recent internet sensations, a dynamic dual narrative, and a familiar, if uncomfortable, story. For as gruesome as Squid Game is, it's familiar. Not in the repackaged IP way, but in the familiar childhood games way. Red light, green light, tug of war, don't step on the cracks or you'll break mom's back, marbles, candy, etc. All the games played in some variation in childhood. Back then, the stakes were low, even if it did feel like the whole world depending on winning freeze tag or Squid Game. Childhood games remind us of simpler times when the worst thing that would happen was that you'd be it. As people age, it's common to look back with fondness on the lava floor monster days and think, my, how oblivious child me was to the realities of the world back then. But not in Squid Game. Games might have felt life and death as a child, but in Squid Game, they actually are. There is no comfort in the old childhood games, and what's worse, the schoolyard bullies are allowed to roam free and take lives at will. Talk about worst fears come true. It sets all the games in nostalgic places and then flips the good feels on their head by making the playground a scene from a nightmare. Squid Game is also familiar in regards to the question of, what are you willing to do to win? Or I should say, what aren't you willing to do to win? Squid Game comes from a long line of games that ask contestants to put their lives on the line, or forces them to. We are used to seeing humans on screen make the choice to do whatever it takes to win, and their anguish is usually for the amusement or benefit of a third party. We're almost desensitized to how gruesome of a situation that is because of how common it's been in pop culture. The shock value of kill or be killed seems to have worn off, allowing millions and millions of viewers to tune in to such a graphic show without batting an eye. Because we're used to the violence of the games, the shows that use it as a plot device are much more accessible to more and more people who have become used to it. Recent examples are Maze Runner, in which participants had to puzzle out a death trap maze to unknowingly help efforts to find a cure for the flare, a pandemic that nearly wiped out everything. There's also, of course, the Hunger Games, where the games were used as a means to subdue an entire population. All except one young tribute was fully expected to die at the games, watched by the entire country, put on by the government, and those who weren't willing to take the lives of others usually had theirs taken very quickly. It's a sick twist on the for-fun TV game shows like Survivor, etc. Alice in Borderlands is a newer Netflix series with the Survivor Killer Games at its center as well. The movie Battle Royale in 2000, based on the book from 1999, is another example of young students forced to fight to the death by the government. The Lord of the Flies novel from 1954 is another, in which a group of plane wreck students have to come together, or fight for dominance, in order to survive on a deserted island. It's not ordered by a government or the ultra-rich, it's merely for survival. Merely. This was adapted into a movie in 1963 and then again in 1990. So far, the examples I've named have either a ruling party's dictates or survival as the catalyst for the extreme violence of the games. It's grotesque, but not as grotesque as the benefactors in Squid Game's motives, which seems to be pure delight in human suffering and death. It's literally a game to them, no different than betting on horses, a connection which the Chess Knight horse player markers in the Glass Bridge game reinforces, surrounded by luxury and anything they could want. It's their entertainment. This makes Squid Game more terrifying than the others. It seems the deaths serve the whims of just a few wealthy individuals, and they can't get enough because it keeps happening again and again, year after year. This unhinged humanity puts me in mind of The Most Dangerous Game, a short story written by Richard Connell in 1924. In this story, a board game hunter, Zaroff, has decided he wants a new challenge and takes to luring ships into his secret island. Squid Game is on a secret island. And when the ships wreck on the rocks of his domain, Zaroff gives all the survivors a choice: be turned over to torture or be hunted and maybe survive. An uncomfortable choice, much like Squid Game's, live in misery and great debt for the rest of your days, or do whatever it takes to win and all your debt will disappear. In The Most Dangerous Game, Zaroff gives those who choose to play food, clothes, and a knife, which, hey, again, familiar, and a 3-hour head start. If they can survive undetected for 3 days, they will win their freedom. None, however, have ever eluded Zaroff and his pistol. Another hunter, Ransford, decries this as terrible, and I'm with him there, but quickly finds himself hunted by Zaroff, who says, "Life is for the strong. Kill or be killed, right?" To evade Zaroff's dogs and death, Ransford jumps off a cliff, which also happens in Squid Game, although they did leave it off on a bit of a cliffhanger, right? And swims back to Zaroff's home to confront him for a final duel. Now this hits like Squid Game, the violence just for someone else's sick fun. And the jungle motif of the VIP room absolutely reinforces this link to Zaroff's Jungle Games. So why would such a show be among Netflix's most watched series? Why are children drawn to the mass killers en masse? How did they even get into Squid Game? What did kids indulge in most during 2020 when the world was locked down? Fall Guys kicked off the summer with hundreds of contestants in colored jumpsuits playing simple, childish Mario Party Battle Royale minigames. Their goal? Not to fall to their death. Round by round, players are eliminated until only one winner remains. Fast forward to Among Us, a mafia-style game where players wear single-colored spacesuits and are identified not by names really, but mainly by colors. This is similar to Squid Game, where workers are identified by numbers and their rank by the shape on their mask. In Among Us, each player has a task appointed they must complete, while imposters run around and try to eliminate the players. And the exact same is true in Squid Game. Number 29, an undercover cop, is asked multiple times why they are not doing their task, and this raises suspicion in the ranks of the workers, who work as a well-practiced team. From then on, 29 is watched closer. When a body is discovered in Among Us, an alarm is sounded and an attempt to identify the imposters is made by the remaining group. The exact same thing happens in Squid Game after number 29 kills the diver. Also, he literally uses the fence to get around the secret base, as does player 67, which is also in Among Us. 29 outs himself as the imposter by asking something he should have already known, as he was there when it happened, according to the others. And I think that this second narrative, the imposter among the workers, helped to tie Squid Game even more to pop culture through Among Us. It doesn't matter if kids haven't watched Squid Game, they know it through games like Roblox and through their favorite YouTubers playing kid-friendly variants of Squid Game. Now, I'm not saying Squid Game is based on Among Us or Fall Guys. Its script had been written for quite a few years already, and Among Us and Fall Guys are relatively new in the scheme of things. It is possible Netflix could have styled some of the characters' outfits after these internet sensations. But what I am saying is that the popularity and success of Fall Guys and Among Us make the concept and even stylings of Squid Game very accessible to such a wide audience. And what's more, the dual narrative in Squid Game, the battle royale viewers have grown familiar with, and the imposter officer acting almost exactly as an imposter would in Among Us, makes Squid Game appeal to viewers across nearly every age group. But these are just some of my thoughts and analysis. What are some of yours? Which of the games was the creepiest for you? Which would be the easiest? Let me know in the comments below. Thank you, friends and fans, for hanging out and talking about Squid Game. If you like creepy pulp culture and lore dives, subscribe so you won't miss the next spooky thing. I'll see you soon! Goodbye.